where Debbie, where Mrs. Heskell teaches. She's our sister, she's our friend, and we're here to give her our support as much as we possibly can. We have never met Mama. Anyone met Mama? No. We have never met Mama, but we know about her. We know a lot about her from the words spoken by Debbie. And I pray that as we minister today, Mama cannot hear us, but those of us who are alive, we will make ourselves right so that when Jesus comes, we can see Mama again. Right, Debbie? I'm sure you're looking forward to that day when you can see her and be with her again. So as we minister to you, may your hearts be blessed and you feel comfort that God is always there.
Eternal faith. What can I say about Angie? Every time I would visit her, her smile would make me happy. People always tell me, oh, you smile too much, but I see where I get it from. Because whenever you see Auntie Vivian, you see the smile on her face before. And I, her death has made me sad. Yes, I have other aunties, but for some reason, Auntie Vivian passing have caused pain in my heart. A pain that I have been running from, not to feel for a very long time. Because I know how it feels to lose a loved one. Sometimes we will talk and I will tell her that she loved my brother more than me. Because whenever I mention his name, our face always lights up. And I will say, Auntie, didn't you love Aisha more than me, man? And she will just laugh. And that fateful Saturday, I had intended to go and visit her in the evening. Because I went to some earlier, but it was too early for visiting. And I had things to do in Monterrey. But when I got the news, my sister told me that Auntie Vivian died. I said, no, because Merlin, I know Merlin not left, and Merlin didn't call me and say anything, but my sister lived away in the States, and she told me, and I want to know how she know that, but Merlin didn't say anything. She said, my brother told her. I said, no, sir, not going to so. Let me call Merlin to confirm, and when I called Merlin, and it pains my heart because I said, God, I want to see Auntie Vivian before she passed. I had prayed the same, asked the same request when my dad, before my dad passing, I said, God, I want to see him before he passed. But he passed and I didn't get to see him. So today it hurts, and it brings memory, and it caused my heart to hurt. But God knows best. It is hard to believe that the angel has packed you home at a time we least expect it. We hardly take in fact that your suddenly demise have expectantly terminated our memories, our moments we enjoy with you. I do wonder if we will ever find anyone to take your place. You left a hollow in our hearts that no one can ever fill, not even halfway. Auntie Vivian, you are a beautiful flower, plucked from the flower bed to a sweet-smelling savor in the presence of your Maker. It's hard to come to terms with the fact that we will never hear from you again. Sweet memories fill me anytime I remember the advice you gave. You always take pleasure in sharing with me whenever I visit you. She will always find time to tell me something and, you know, about life and what to do from what not to do. And that will remain in my heart. The smile you left in my heart anytime I will come and visit you, it's gone now, never to come back. Oh, how sad I feel until now. As you ascend to heaven, Know that your teaching will have, as you ascend to heaven, know that your teaching will live on in our hearts, and your love will continue to light our path. You were a mother figure, a friend, and a guiding light that we were all blessed to have in our lives. Auntie Vivian, you left without saying goodbye, but I don't blame you. It's the cold hand of death that took you away from us, but not even the cold hands of death can take the memories of you from our hearts. Rest in peace.
Love cannot hurt a child.
She has no sorrow to die. She has scent of gladness on wings, to be lost in the blue of the sky. She has run and leaped with the rains. She has taken the wind on her breast. In loving memory of a life well lived.
Oh, wow. just made that decision. I've just made that decision that when the road is covered yonder, we will be there. By God's grace, let's be there.
I'm sharing about children by Mr. Michael Jackson. He will tell you who he is.
God is good.
All
and all the time. Officiating ministers, saints of God, brothers and sisters in Christ, the bereaved family, greetings in the name of Jesus Christ. As was said earlier, the name is Michael Jackson, and I'm your servant. The counselor for the White House division. My colleague Justice, Brother Amos, he said not to lay hands on anyone. But the message or the tribute here, my brothers and sisters in Christ, Myrtle Estella Morris, her name was called. And she answered. She lived a life. God lent her to us. And she was transitioned on March 2. But between the date of birth and the date of transition, my brothers and sisters in Christ, there is a dash. She lived her life. However it was, it more than the 3 scores and 10, and when it reached 8, the 4 scores. She lived her life. She made her mark. And what we got to do, my brothers and sisters in Christ, is not just to remember the good memories, but I beg of you one thing. Those of you who are left behind, there is a lesson to be learned. One, we are made for one purpose only, and it's to serve God. And not in serving God, we serve others. So I remind myself, and I'm here to remind you, that the acronym JOY speaks about Jesus first, seeking first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness and all other things shall be added unto you. So it's Jesus first, others second, and yourself last. So I remind you about self-denial today. And those who are left behind, especially the family, the daughter, the niece, all the family members, both immediate and extended, we must reach out to them. Offer that comfort, lend that support. And I'm not just speaking about just today or tomorrow, but months and years from now, we must continually remember them. If we are far apart in distance, we remember them in our prayers. So, this, Miss Dindin, Mama, she lived her life. We can sing the song, I Remember Mama, in a happy way. But today, let us not weep like there is no hope. Because weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. So in closing, I'm reminded of the Beatitudes in Matthew 5. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. God bless you in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you very much, Justice. All right. We are going to continue our program with the reading of the second lesson. Revelation 21, verses 1 to 7. And this will be done by Shad, Yano, Dino, Iman, and it is great grandson. Thank you for your correction.
This shows her loving, nurturing, and caring.
caring personality and she didn't love everyone, but her love for her one and only child, Merlin, was unconditional and no no bounds. She ensured she had all she needs and was short of nothing. This special love also extends to her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. They were the apples of her eyes. And she didn't love the kitchen. She loved to cook. Whether it's inside or outside, she's always cooking up a storm. She's always creating culinary delights that would tantalize the taste buds and warm the soul. The smell of freshly baked potatoes and puddings were a reminder of her love and care. She would also ensure to invite her neighbor to experience and learn her skill, especially when she's making babies and hot chocolate. But you see, it's not just her cooking skills that I will remember. It was the story she would tell, tales of long time past, the hardships endured, the triumphs celebrated. Each word was like a thread weaving together our family history. As I stand here now reminiscing about my dear aunt, I'm filled with a sense of gratitude for the time we shared. Her presence may no longer be with us, but her spirit lives on in the memories we hold dear. She was a pillar of strength, a beacon of light in the darkness, and for that I am eternally grateful. And so, as we say our final goodbyes to our beloved aunt, we take comfort in knowing that she's now at peace, watching over us from above. Though she may no longer be with us physically, her spirit lives on in our memories we hold dear. We will carry her love with us always and continue to honor and share her legacy. Rest in peace, Aunt Didin. You will forever be in our hearts. Thank you.
Rest in peace, Auntie Gideon. I must admire her. Sister Gideon, there was no dull moment around her. She was always joyful. Whenever we would go and give her communion as a shutting, you would never go there and she's not happy. Always smiling and very cheerful. So on behalf of Pastor Donald Hill, Board of Elders and Leaders, and all the members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church Belmont, we wish to express our deepest sympathy to each member of the bereaved family. And we hope and trust that you will not serve others who have no hope. Because Sister Lillian, she lived a very good life at a good age and also a spiritual life. So let's, by God's grace, be faithful to him so that when he shall come, all of us together will meet him in peace. At this time we are going to have lift an offering in aid of community services. We are going to sing the song, "When Peace Like a River Attended My Way." Oh God, just before we do that, let's have prayer. Let us pray. Great God, we thank you for life and the benefit it offers. We thank you for being so good to us, you have been our provider. We ask you, God, that you will bless us continually. And we pray, God, that what you have blessed us with, that we will remember to return a part to you. As we are about to collect that part, we ask that you will bless it and that it will be used for the purpose intended, we ask. In Jesus' name. Amen. When peace like a river attended my way.
When peace like a river.
this time we will have the eulogy by Elder Vivita present here this time.
Her daughter. started making chocolate. Yes, nowadays we call it chocolate. But in the Jamaican jargon, it's chocolate. Yes, the one you have to break down and use to make chocolate tea Sunday morning or a Christmas morning. Yes, man, the one with the eyes on the top. You remember that one?
Yes.
I was told she taught younger persons to make bami and chocolate from scratch. I hope one of these persons is Merlene or April. You two ladies cannot allow Miss Diggins' legacy to die. You must find a way to carry on this craft. I learned she also taught some individuals to cook, wash, and iron. She was a great domestic helper, as stated by Bongo, otherwise known as Pet. While Miss Diddin was busy with her life, somebody was busy watching her. He watched her every move. You see, she was a short woman with a very beautiful smile and a great personality. This person was captivated by her and was totally swept off his feet. He made his plans as to when he would make his move. I imagine him singing Michael Bolton's song, "When man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing else. He trade the world for the good things he's found." When he made his move, Miss Diddin in return said, "It's been a long time. I've been admiring you, my baby. It's been a long time. I've been admiring you, my baby. Every night I go to sleep, I see you in my dreams." Hey, what a thing. Can you guess who that person was who made that move? Yes, he was Stephen Augustus Morris, of course. He was not going to allow her to slip through his fingers like sand. Miss Diddin was not going to allow that to happen either. A lasting friendship developed. They later tied the knot and became husband and wife. They were blessed with a beautiful baby girl whom they named the three M's, Merlin, Margaret, Morris. Whatever they were thinking, she was M-M-M. This baby brought joy to their lives. And guess what? Was their only child. Her husband predeceased her 48 years ago. This brought great sadness that someone so sweet was taken from them. Death is the most cruel enemy. I bet some of you did not know that she was married again. Yes, man. She was married to Hubert Finley. But guess what? She really loved Morris so much that she never added Finley. Don't ask me why. And it's too late for you to ask her now, because she cannot answer you. The Bible said, "He that hath friends must show himself, herself, friendly." Miss Diddin loved people and valued them more than things. What I find out now loved people, but not Mr. Day. She loved people and had many friends. Some of these include Bongo, boys known as Pep, Frankie, Desley, Charlotte, otherwise known as Charlotte, who called her regularly, Debian, Oakley Blythe, and she was with her the last week before she passed. Mortimer, otherwise known as Buta, her nephew, who took her to her doctor's appointment. And Mama Dorothy Brightson, Miss Lucy, was the last person to comb her hair before she was admitted in the hospital. Kirk, otherwise known as Adrian, could not pass without hearing from Miss Bibi, "Your happy start out yourself," and then she would turn to her grandchildren and say, "I'm a little comrade bridging that man. You know what? I'm a little comrade bridging." Miss Bibi let the world know when anyone came to visit her and gave her a gift. She would put it on her bed or somewhere near. And when anybody came to visit, she was not quiet about it. She was always appreciative of the simplest thing anyone did for her. The world, Westmoreland, and in particular Mount Airy, needs more Miss Diddy. She loved her nephews, nieces, and family members, and was not afraid to let the world know. Mr. Brenner Wright, her son-in-law, stood by Merlin, and he gave her the support or the help she needed when Miss Diddy needed it most. Miss Diddy loved him, and she loved when she cooked the one-pot meals and baked Toto. She had a feast and was so happy that he baked those Totos. There are two persons who topped Miss Diddy's love list. One is Michael, her first great grandchild, and the other is April, was her grandma's heartbeat. April never got a chance to visit her that day before she died. Miss Diddy just kept on asking for her, as if she was the only person in the world that mattered, and she would not stop asking until she got the information she needed, which satisfied her. Talk about food. Miss Diddy loved food, especially her purple yam, her dumplings, and her fried chicken. You know which part of the chicken she loved the most? The leg and the thigh. And when she got it, she would eat the thigh, but she would put up the leg for Bamba. She often visited her granddaughter Debian in Brighton. When she was coming home, she stopped at a grocery shop and bought a small bread. Why did she buy a small bread? Maybe because she was small and short. The bread was later named Miss Diddy Bread. What a thing, I would never think to sell Miss Diddy Bread. So Merlin and April, you need to go to that grocery shop and get the returns from Miss Diddy Bread. Of all the love Miss Diddy had, her love for God surpassed them all. She was a wise woman and chose God because he first chose her. On May 20, 1995, she gave her life to God and was baptized. She became a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church right here in Belmont. Pastor Donald Hale and Elders Charles and Vita Young served her final communion in November 2023. She continued to be a member of this church until her passing. Miss Didding, on February 23, 2024, complained of a pain in her stomach. She was taken to the doctor and was admitted at the Samuel Lamar Public General Hospital. While there, her condition worsened. She bade goodbye to this world on March 2, 2024. We have lost a very loving and lovable person, a woman with a sharp brain. She seemed not to have forgotten anything. Kind-hearted and generous person. Mount Airy, the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Belmont, will never be the same without her. She has left to mourn her passing daughter, Merlin, son-in-law, Breno, three grandchildren, Coloration, otherwise known as April, Debbie and Dryden Heslop, Shadiz, otherwise known as Samantha. Six great-grandchildren, Michael, Shadina, Letitia, Mia, Aiden, and Tal Janae. Her siblings, Bas, Ines, Cherry, Roy, and Rosetta predeceased her. Linford, otherwise known as Son, is the only surviving sibling. She has left a host of nieces, nephews, relatives, friends, and church family. The signs of the times are fast fulfilling. Everywhere we turn is bloodshed upon bloodshed, blood touching blood. Matthew 24 is being fulfilled before our very eyes. Those of us who have known God as our personal Savior, we need to continue on this path. To those of you who have not yet chosen Him to be your Savior, the time to do it is now. Time is running out, and time waits on no man. As the signs are fulfilled, let us be ready to meet Jesus when He comes. Signs of the times are everywhere, and there's a brand no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more funeral trains, no more hospitals, just no more, no more, no more. Come, go with me. Here, when we need to hear a word from God, the person who will bring the word to us today is our pastor, Pastor Donald Hill. He's a friend of people, but more than all, he's a servant of God. I crave for him your very undivided attention, and I pray that you will breathe a prayer in your heart that as God speaks to him and he speaks to you, you will listen and do. Before he comes to speak to us, however, we'll be favored with a very special song of meditation by Elder Amos Ransom.
why you sing like you. I'd like to extend my deepest condolence to the daughter and other family members of our beloved sister. All that has been said is enough. So I will say something that has not yet been said. But we grieve with you and pray that the support that you receive today will prove encouraging and more so we will all get a blessing from the service. Amen. Incidentally, she is sleeping and she doesn't know that. And when we sleep in our home, in our bed, or sleep like her, we don't know either. Somebody else knows when we're sleeping, but we don't know. God knows that she is sleeping, and Jesus said to them at the graveside of Lazarus, he sleepeth. And they laugh at him. But then he says, okay, we're going to wake him. There are also people who are alive who don't even know they're alive. And we know that they're alive. There are persons who are in coma. And there are persons who are alive, who are living, but they're not alive. There are persons who are living, but not alive. Sounds strange. The Bible says that when we are outside of Christ, we are dead in our trespasses and sin. And those who don't remember God and don't have time for God are dead and don't even know they're dead. When people think about what means a lot to them, normally. And most times what means a lot to people is what they feel they can get something from. They can get something out of it. And the focus is to pay more attention to the present life, because there is wealth and luxury and power and all the others. So we pay more attention to the present life. But we have heard it again and again, but more than that, we have seen evidence of it, that a man's life has nothing to do, or the other way around, everything a person has nothing to do with his life. We're alive because of God's blessing. That doesn't have anything to do with what we own. And so, no one lives outside of God. Whether he's a baptized, practicing Christian or not, no one lives outside of God. In him, we live and move and have our being. Paul spoke those words to some philosophers who didn't have time for God. But he used their own philosophy and brought home a spiritual truth to them that they could not deny. And he said to them, you worship of God, and you says to the unknown God, but I want to tell you about him. It is in him we live and move and have our being. Amen. And so, you know, the budget speech was read already. Tell us about get money and spend money. Well, we want to look at how we get life and how we should maintain life. Amen. Yes. Bible says, I set before you today life and death. Choose life and live. But if you disobey, you shall die. God gives life. When we separate ourselves from God, we deprive ourselves of life. We might be living, but we're not alive. Because the Bible says in 1 John 5 and verse 12 that only he who hath the Son has life. We're living because food is the start of life and we have air. We're living because we're breathing. But that's not all about life. He that hath the Son hath life. And even if he died, he will raise him up in the last day. Because the life that the Son gives is abundant life, eternal life. Amen. So in St. John, the 6th chapter, and reading from verse 48, says, Jesus says to the hearers, speaking directly to the Jews, I am the bread of life. And he says, your fathers ate manna, and they are dead. So food is the start of life. It keeps us alive. But that's not life in all its fullness. That's life to deal with earthly cares, temporal stuff. But the life that Christ talks about is eternal life. I am the bread of life. So how do we get this life? He says, your fathers ate to keep themselves alive, but they are dead. They are dead. They ate manna in the wilderness, and they are dead. This is the bread, pointing to himself. I am the bread which came down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof, and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. And the Jews had a problem with this language. And they were murmuring. And he said, listen to them. He said, he listened to them and said this. Verily, verily, I say to you, except you eat my flesh, the flesh of the Son of Man, and drink my blood, you will have no life in you. They were thinking, they were listening to him. And yet he says, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. They were listening to him. They were living, but they didn't have life. Where are you holy week, they said. There's one day that we know that is holy. And it's the Sabbath. And it's not contentious. It has not, I don't say contentiously. Or the inside that we made. I say it because that's how it is. And that's what the Bible says. Thursday is when they have the supper. And when he washed the feet of the disciples, Friday he was crucified. He rose on the first day. Amen. Slept in the grave on the Sabbath. We don't have two holy days in the week.
6 days
shall no labor. And no ALL or labor. For the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord.
In it.
Thou shalt do no work. It is the Sabbath of the Lord.
But that's not the point. But that came in because of the Holy Week that we are in.
If you don't eat, you have no life in you.
Or do I get life by eating your flesh? Well, it is the spirit, verse 63, that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. So even if you eat the bread, you'll die. Communion, you still die. But the words which I speak unto you, they are spiritual and they are living words. Amen. So there is no life outside of Jesus. We live and move and exist because He gives us life. All of us, whether we go to church or not, owe it to ourselves to be grateful to the Lord. The Bible says in the 100th division of the Psalm, it is He that hath made us, not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. So we are to give God the glory. Amen. Bless His name. Bless His name. John 15, 1 to 5, that's it. I am the true vine, Jesus says. My Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth no fruit is taken away. And every branch that beareth fruit, He purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, you are clean through the Word. You are clean through the Word which I have spoken to you. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy Word is true. John 17:17. Abide in me, that's the Word. Thy in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself, no more can you except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you don't exist. Amen. Without me, it is not an evil thing to serve God. Those who go to church did not establish church. Jesus said, I build my church. It's not church people set up church. Well, maybe I should rephrase. As people are going to bed, they're waking up and saying they got a dream to raise up a church and call the name thereof. Come everybody, come. And I will give you, make you have blessings. And anything you want, you will get. Just do what I say. But Jesus said, I build my church. We don't have any church. We can't send anybody to hell. And any church you go, people come in and you're preaching and tell you you're going to hell. And they come and help you. You don't need to come up here. Because if you don't reach there red, then there's no say going here. I'm preaching, I can't look to help you. Then we have a man tell you to go ahead. He know that. And if I preach, you tell him to go ahead, but he can't help you. You don't need to come here. We live it and exist because of God. And we are to remember that it is He that gives us strength to get well. Some people don't give church anything and they're rich. Some get chopper money. God take chopper money. You don't really ask for it, but if you know that you love God and you never ask for it, the Lord bless you with your heart. By the time you say, Lord, have mercy and drop it, God bless you. Watch it. And I'll get it done.
God who wanted. God give you life, and if you are expressing gratitude for life, that is your God business. I am not God. What will you? The point I made. Everybody, whether you are a Christian or not, owe it to God to give him the glory that is due to him. So if you're not starting to give God praise because you're not baptized, very grateful. And ungratefulness is worse than war. Remember the Lord. We live and breathe and move and exist because of him. Everybody gets life from God. But living is not at all. Because when we eat and drink and we live, that's just temporary stuff. But he says, abide in me and I in you, so you get abundant life. We're alive now, but many who are alive, who are living, are only living because they are breathing. But they are dead, only that they are not stiff. But to have life and have it more abundantly, we must have the Son. He that hath the Son hath life.
For his time, we have presented to us the Word of God. And I hope and trust that we won't have to look around, but whatsoever fits us, don't take it for ourselves. We are going to have the prayer for the very family. We're going to ask the very family to remain seated. We're going to ask the other members of the congregation, please stand as we pray. You have been on the island, this time you go to his prayer. Let us pray. Tell my God and Father, you are God and there is no one like you. We are thankful, God, that you have preserved our life to witness this in our souls. We ask God that you will help, that we will use it to mark the time will come if we shall die. That we make our call in our election truth. I pray that we are special for each member of the very family. Pray, God, that you will not mourn those who have no hope, but just remember always that Jesus is the one who gives life and he is the only one who can take it away. Pray that you will keep the family members together, yet that they always be reminded that you are coming soon and they will put their houses in order. Whether we are ready or not, you are coming. So help us to be prepared to meet you in peace. I pray, God, that you will provide for them. Help them that they will always remember their deceased one in a very happy way. Help all of us, oh God, that who are here, that we will make our call in our election short. Death will not give an invitation, but he will come when he is ready. So I pray, oh God, that you will help us to be prepared so that any time we die, we'll be able to be ready to meet you in peace. I pray that you will continue to be with us. Keep us faithful so that when you shall in your kingdom come, all of us that are in here, with those who are prepared to meet you, we go home and to meet you eternally and to live with you forever. We ask as you say, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we soon come with you. Amen. We sit, you have been a very good audience. We are just going to have the recessionary. We listen to the instruction. We are going to sing for our recessionary. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus at the singing of the first verse. And when we are through with the chorus, we are going to do the start the second one. We are going to ask the platform party to leave along with the choir members, followed by the casket and the family members and then the other members of the congregation. Let's stand as we sing this song. Then when we finish this song, we're going to move on to the next one.
Good afternoon.